the Super Drive Time Show with KC.
Show number one lifestyle station, City 1051. Okay, who am I? In case you're asking who that was, that was Jim Mike. Yeah?
Is this a good time to put the put out a disclaimer? Is this a good time?
It's a pretty bad time. Well, you can still put it out anyway.
Okay, so I disclaim this song in all intents and purposes. Anyone that buys this song, buys it or streams it at your peril. Thank you.
Okay, wait, hold on.
Say that again.
I Jim Ike, of various addresses and countries, disclaim the song "Who Am I?" I'll come with legal lingo later.
You know the funny thing, yeah, like it was a fantastic experiment back then. Like absolutely, you know, it was good. It was refreshing.
I had friends that we created this, had a good laugh at ourselves, had a good laugh at people that came at us to say it's a bad song. I think the beauty of life for me is the ability to laugh at yourself
and take criticism, because it seems like nowadays, especially in the movie slash music, it's so
there's some things that create, what is the terminology, beef.
Yeah,
there's some things that I see people on social media going after themselves.
No, you listen to it, you're like,
yo, back in the day when men were men, dude. Yeah. I'll pull up on you, we'll have a conversation. If it involves fisticuffs, we'll do it. We'll go have a beer. They go separate us. We'll go drink right after that and either talk business and chicks. Yeah. It's over. Everybody just carries off for days on end, goes on Insta, calls people out.
Exactly.
We don't call out, bro. I pull up.
And the funny thing is, nobody's even pulling up anymore. Nobody's even exchanging blows. Everything is on Twitter.
It's a man thing. I can't believe you just did this. We had a conversation. You chilled. It's no big deal. You have a laugh. You know how many people we disagreed with in the course of our career back in the day? I'm still great friends with.
Yeah.
It just usually starts with somebody, you know, doing something on tour.
Yeah.
And then you pull up and you have a conversation and it's over. Everybody's so...
throw hands if you need to, but at the end of the day...
throw hands. I mean, you need a hand sometimes so that people understand where you're coming from.
Exactly.
And that's what the street is about. That's what being good-natured is about.
Do you feel like social media in a way kind of changed things? It kind of made people soft in a way?
The paradigm in every way that's effective to the concept of manhood was totally undermined and watered down. Okay, I mean, what do you teach your boys? You teach your boys to handle situations with their intellect, and then when they're out there in the field and they get into this boyish altercations, what do? You go separate them. So every problem he has in life, you'll have to step in and take charge. That's a problem.
That's a problem for the kid already.
That's a problem. He becomes totally dependent on
you.
On you. And he's no. And then the variables out there will eat him up once he gets into it. So I let him resolve matters. Sometimes when he's getting out of hand, of course you step in. Basically, boys will be boys, man. Men will be men. You know, let it be. Have a beer. You know, get off your high horse. You know, have a drink.
Yeah.
And do you know how many business deals have closed after arguments?
Mm.
Now you know my boundaries. Now you understand who I am. Now
and
you
understand. There's the element of respect now.
That respect more than anything. You're very intelligent. And after now, everybody just carries on. There's no reconciliation. Nobody wants to shake hands and carry on. No,
they see each other at events. They walk past.
Dude, I've had people pull up on me before because of something I did back in the day, and they jumped me. And I took out as many as I can, and they beat the crap out of me. And then after that, I was swinging. I never stopped swinging until I went down. I kept swinging. One of them stopped it and said, no, man, I mean, that's a man right there. And then we shook hands. I had some money. I took them out. We had a drink. After drinking, those dudes became my ride and die.
Till today.
Dude, I know their kids in the States as we speak. We hang out. We do stuff. Relationship that's spanned over a decade or and a half. I mean, you can't do that if I carried on, oh, you guys jumped one guy. And no. And what I did deserved to be jumped, by the way. So, I took somebody's girl amongst them.
Oh, my days.
And I wasn't painful about it.
But the funny thing is, even if you take somebody's girl, like, should you be jumped because
of that? No, it was how I did it, my nigga.
How'd you do it? How'd you do it?
I did it and called everybody out. I put it in their faces. So they said, okay. Taking it would have taken it.
Yeah.
Taking how would have left you alone. But calling us out, now we're coming for you.
Exactly.
So I had to stand my ground. And I rose solo. That's the thing about me.
And when hands were being thrown, was the girl among...
No, she heard about it later, of course, my face was, when I got back, should have been an altercation. But instead of that, she was trying to go to the police. And I said, are you kidding me?
Come on,
we don't call the police then. And also, later we met again. Somebody was a mediator.
Yeah.
We didn't settle completely that day. We just shook hands a little. But someone was a mediator. We had a drink. And I found that these are extremely intelligent young men that had drive, that had purpose, they were moving. So we aligned our purpose together. And we started working together. Eventually, one of them became my lawyer.
Fantastic.
I'm telling you, became my foundation lawyer. And then, you know, I mean, we did a lot. We made money together. Well, it was a brotherhood. Anybody that had a kid would roll up there, make some noise, make him know that he's loved and he's appreciated.
It's not deeper than this.
And after that, everybody started traveling out. And I made it a point, anytime I roll onto any of their countries, I reach out to them. We're friends till this day. Of the six guys that jumped me, I'm still friends with about two of them till today.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. That's what I'm talking about. Okay. So we mentioned, you know, being confrontational, like what social media has done, and we cannot in any way downplay social media.
Yeah.
And basically, it's centered around your new movie coming out soon. Mm. I think it's coming out on the 27th.
August.
Yeah, 2 days from now.
Yes, 2 days from now.
Okay. And the name of the movie is called Bad Comments.
That's
and
right.
Do you want to talk to us about this movie, because you are the executive producer of this movie as well? So this is a personal project for you, so talk to us about it.
I couldn't have put it better. When we created this, for about 5-6 years, I was tired of putting my affairs in the hands of people that were far less passionate than I am. So
yeah,
we decided, let me take charge of all my platforms, my investments. And so it needed a complete haters from the industry, and that's what I did. I went to secure my future, so to speak. And I decided anytime I'm coming back, I'm going to come back with something that was totally going to blow everything else out of the waters. I wanted to center a story, consecrate a story around the common denominator, something that would lack a frame of reference. I didn't want it to be called a Nollywood, Bollywood, or Hollywood film.
Yeah.
I just wanted a
universally viable
film, a film that was totally unorthodox, but yet, you know, relatable.
Yep.
So I had to find that common denominator, and that common denominator is the platform that we exist in, even from 2 years old to 90 years old. It doesn't matter your idiosyncrasy, it doesn't matter your political or religious affiliation, it doesn't matter your creed, religion, and status. It just doesn't matter where you are, whatever is your race. A French guy, an African guy, an Arab can walk in and see this movie and say, damn, that's me in that space. So the only space that exists with that common denominator is a social media or internet space. So we created our story around there. The thing is that I wanted to put a searchlight on all the actors in this space. A lot of people might say it's a satire or even a tongue-in-cheek portrayal of the actors that exist in that space. But yes, I wanted to force a conversation. People, this space, this platform, this establishment has created untold opportunities for people, more or less like a shortcut to fame and fortune, right?
Yeah.
It has also been the center stage for tragedies.
Unfortunate
kids between
events.
15, 19 years are losing their life at a rapidity. The suicide rate is about 77% at the moment between kids of that age. And most of them come from this internet, from depression, from suicidal, you know, projection of whether people have made it out to them. And do you know this also, it's most prevalent around the low-income to mid-income societies, namely us. It's just that we don't talk about it. We don't have enough conversation about it. I remember my little niece had a situation, some white kids, you know, bullied her, and immediately they were talking about psychiatrists, taking her to see that person, and saying, it doesn't happen. You know what we went through as kids, what we're still going through, what people are going through in this space, and people are not just addressing it. There's a mental health issue here. There's an advocacy behind it. So beyond entertainment, there's an advocacy. There are conversations that are not being held at the helm of affairs and different realms of people that change, you know, pivotal conversations and all that.
And
so,
speaking of the helms of affairs, like, yes, it only seems like the only time anything social media is being addressed is when it directly affects them.
Yes, and when you then they shut down.
You now start to address
oh,
it.
Hell, There you go.
Like when it becomes an issue with somebody or a select group of people, it doesn't get talked
about.
Dude,
let's call it what it is. It's the elite. It is elites. When they wake up and they decide that the narrative is not working to their, you know, to their gain.
To their gain, yes.
To their ulterior motives, they shut things down. That is the answer to it. You don't shut things down. There's a table. You invite the players to the table and you have a conversation. It's called modernity. It's called right of speech. It's called people having, you know, leads to their access to their fundamental human rights. That's what it's about. That's what this conversation. We created this film as a satire to address a public ill and force people, if for nothing, to have a conversation and push the narrative of results, okay, of solutions to this dire problem, because it's a dire problem. Kids are losing their lives at a rapidity, and it's become culturally cool all of a sudden to project hate and poison.
Exactly,
on
yes,
platform.
Yes.
People that even created it are beginning to distance themselves from it. We all heard when the CEO of Google came out to say that it's become the beehive of idiots. For a creator to say that, my brother, then
shows you there's a lot.
Something has to be addressed.
Okay, I've got Jim Mike right here on the Super Drive Time Show. We're going to be talking about a lot more. Quick break, and I'll be right back. Okay, there's so much to discuss. The new movie coming out soon, 2 days from now, is called Bad Comments. Stick around.
It's the Super Drive Time Show with KC.
It's your number one lifestyle station, City 1051. Time check right now. This is 5:39 in the city of Lagos. Okay, I've still got Jim Ike right here with me. And we're talking about his new movie called Bad Comments. And yo, I feel like this movie is coming out at such a very good time, because you have people, women that are insecure about their bodies because of what people say on social media. You have people that are insecure about whatever they create. It could be music, it could be art, it could be anything, just because somebody said something that they don't like personally, they generalize that, make it look like that person is being crazy for doing what they do. That puts food on the table. You know, you have different people doing different things. You have different people laughing at you because you're going through something, probably a divorce, or you know, you lost your dad. It could be the littlest things that you are like, why would you make fun of somebody because of that? Now, somebody, I don't want to call the person's name, but somebody who is going through something, you know, actually posted about how you handled a cyber bully. Mm. The person talked about it, and the next thing that they could say was, how far away your wife now? And I really don't understand why you would say that about this person, like, just because of the person. And I have respect for the person. I don't want to call the person's name and everything, because we had an interview recently. The next thing you could say when the person was saying something about how you reacted to that cyberbully, the next thing somebody could say was, how far away your wife? And the sad thing is, I know this person that said, how far away your wife? Is actually somebody I follow on social media.
They think it's a joke.
It's even your friends, people that
know you
personally, that can be the most vile human beings out there. Now, and I want to ask you on a personal level, with all these things in mind, how people go through serious personal stuff. I don't want to use the S word or the F word, because it's pissing me off in a way. But how people go through stuff, should you be blamed for the way you choose to address it? Should anybody be blamed? Should there be some type of cap or restriction on how people choose to address how they are cyber bullied?
Boundaries can be set. We all understand that. It's no fault of yours. Yes, our engagement. Remember, what we intend to have is a wide spectrum of conversation. I'll start with people that are considered the anti-heroes, the ones that people think have had an easier right to the better life, you know, the celebrities, so to speak. So we made a movie and told our story through the prism of the celebrity. Are we doing too much, truthfully? And are there far more elegant, far more gracious ways we can portray and we exhibit our wealth and our gifts without, you know, rubbing it in people's faces? Is our intention self-gratification as opposed to what we preach, which is motivation?
Yeah.
Okay, so this conversation must be had. There are far more classier ways you can show that I'm successful without just being ostentatious about it. And because the people you offend on the other end, and when the other people on the other end begin to question themselves, am I doing enough? Am I working hard enough? Why am I getting the short end of the stick? It can begin to make them infuriated. It can begin to, you know, make them nurse very adverse feelings towards you. Having said that, the people on the other end also need to understand that I mean, this thing about God time is the best. Yeah, well, some people like to carry that adage like a water on their head from the stream. But the truth of the matter is that your lane is very specifically built for you. As long as you're putting in that work, as long as your singular belief in God is there, as long as you've went out there to do the right thing, which is educate your mind, open your mind, and pursue your goals, it is enough. You will get there. You will make things, you know, eventually arrive for yourself. You don't have to look at the lane and that person is traveling. If I tell you of a fact what goes on behind the scene of that person you look up to, that person you hero worship, that person you want their life, you will be graciously happy, deliriously happy with your life. Okay? You never know what's going on behind the scene.
People feel money is everything.
Yeah, people just feel that, you know, there's a time in my life where I thought a certain figure will make me the happiest person in the world. I crossed that figure three times over and I found that I was still wanting in so many parts of my life. And then it took me my mid-30s to begin to understand that, oh, hold up a minute, it's okay for me to pursue this goal. It's okay for me to be transactional. It's okay for me to make sure that I meet all my financial goals.
Yeah.
But it's not what really fulfilled me at the end of the day that made me, brought me so much happiness, was a certain decision and choices that I took that was very deliberate, and it was not for financial gain. It was a very deliberate choices for my mental health, to disassociate myself from certain people, cut off certain people, you know, put myself in a space that does not coexist with the industry, and choose certain persons to be part of my life that will speak true to my soul and spirit, that had nothing to do with behind kissings, for lack of better word.
Yeah.
And I just wanted a specific kind of persons. I wanted a specific kind of route that is not clustered with people that had certain belief system. And things drastically changed overnight. And then I began to wonder, why didn't I get on this road earlier, this journey earlier, until I perfected it? So you must understand that life is constantly moving. There are variables you sort that sometimes you meet that will not bring fulfillment. And I promise you, it's usually not financial. My brother, I'm not telling you being broke is joy. Okay? Get that money. Get your bag secured. But don't make it about your life. Live while you're doing it. A lot of people are not living.
Mm.
They're so existing in that space called social media that they've forgotten to live. Some of them have even met their targets while being in social media. They don't know how to live anymore because the new reality is this surreal existence in there. Go to my social media page. I hardly post pictures of my marriage, my children or my personal life or my family. No.
Because it's personal for a reason.
It's personal. There's a reason. There are three tiers of existence for me as an ideology while I'm a part of this industry. There's a private life, there's a secret life, there's a public life. In my public life, I've given everything there is. For years. With my blood, sweat and tears. My private life is mine. There's a small circle of people that has access to it. People that have blessed me in my life. People that will stand behind me. People that will question whatever public opinion has about me. Those are the people you need in there. Your secret life is strictly for you, your children. It doesn't even extend to your extended family. There are things about my partner and my children that is between us that my sisters don't know. It's my secret life. You must demarcate them.
Okay, thank you. Like that is. I was quiet for a minute, but I think I really needed to hear that. Oh, yeah. But before we head back to the movie, I still feel like this is still part of the movie because it's still part of the message.
Absolutely.
Let's for a minute talk about, you know, that guy that did what he did, yes. Cyberbullying you personally, yeah, because. Yeah. I've checked you out on social media several times. There's a reason you don't follow anybody on Instagram. Correct me if I'm wrong, you don't follow anybody on Instagram.
No, it's not. It's a marketplace. Exactly. It's there for marketing. I believe I don't have to follow you to validate my relationship with you.
Exactly. You don't need it because you have personal. A kid. Yeah. If your kid is on social media, you don't follow them, doesn't mean you don't love them. Obviously not.
There you go.
So, the guy that did what he did, you mentioned the fact that, okay, yes, several times, you're not going to stop. You're going to keep addressing things that needs to be addressed.
Absolutely.
You addressed that. What is your relationship with that guy now?
It's all for good because I tell you, I'm the kind of guy that pulls up and then makes peace. I'm highly trained in the skill of persuasion and engagement and civility. I'm also highly trained in the skill of violence and conflict.
If it comes to that,
yeah, if I have to defend myself, I will. You know, and I won't defend myself. You have to be better trained to survive. So there's something in question here, my integrity. I just buried hundreds of millions in a project and someone was trying to kill it because it was chasing clout. I came to have a conversation and you won't let me have a conversation. Something went down. But like men, we resolved it. There has to be a resolution. What's the whole point? I will never pull up if I don't have a resolution in mind. Okay, so yeah, we did it in the days of old. I didn't believe in coming to. He said it. It took days.
Yeah, it took.
But you. But people forget that you can't say things to certain people. Was it enough, Mr. Tedola, the other time? Some people made some accusations about him. Then he spent his resources. Didn't he find them? So you can't go after men of means and resources and think that if they have the motivation to find you, they won't find you. It took somebody that's close to him to tell us where he was. Simple. Somebody that his motivation to was money.
The guy even asked a question, are you found
because
me? How did you find
me? Yeah, I came at a time when he didn't expect me to be there. And it was somebody close to him that for a price told me where he was. I reached out to my street people and said, hey, I want this person found. And they brought me the person that will find him and I paid the price and I found him. And when I got there, I said, we're going to have a conversation. But because it's you that attacked me, the conversation won't be traditional. Mm. And you have to come to that table. You have to be forced to come to that table. Because it's me you're causing harm. Mm. And he refused. So I did it the jungle justice way. And so he had to relent. And we came to the table. So when we come...
That same table we didn't want to come to.
You have to come to the table. If I want you to come to the table, you come to the table. So we had it. As long as you're the one that did the attack, that came after me. Because let me tell you, I have spent resources to make sure that I perfected the act of minding my business. I'm deaf, dumb, and mute to whatever anybody's doing out there. If you're buying private jet, I'm too blessed to notice all that. I'm too hardworking and too focused on my game to even know what any other person is doing. I made it a point, except it's a national discourse where my opinion is sought specifically. Ask me, have you ever seen me in any club? I know you hang out. Have you ever seen me in airplane? Have you ever seen me like people are gathered somewhere and then you find... No. I said I spent extreme resources to remove myself and people I love from public domain. So when somebody moves mountains to find me and make me a target, then I will respond in kind with every prejudice necessary because I know you sought me. Because there's no reason for it. I don't care if you're a mass murderer. I will never judge you. I will never come into your space. And even if when it's sought, I will refuse to respond. So when people come after me, that is why I take it personal. Because I do everything to disassociate myself from that discussion concerning people. I fired people because somebody gossiped in my office about someone. I'll fire you. Very proficient people. So people like him that did it, there has to be consequences. There's cause and effect for every action you take in this life. You're not a small child. You're not a child. You're an adult, so you should bear responsibility for it. And those were the things I said to him when he finally came to the table. And funny enough, he's a very intelligent person.
Yeah.
He is. So we had a conversation, shook hands like men. I offered beer. It wasn't taken. But we all left in good faith.
So it wasn't taken?
No, it wasn't taken. Well, the brushing was necessary.
My name is Casey, and I'm a little scared right now. But this is the Super Drive Time Show on your number one lifestyle station. Now to wrap things up, bad comments coming out in 2 days. What can people expect from this movie?
It is all of us. Bad comment was created with you in mind. You know, sometimes I hear the propensity hub, for lack of a better term, where people say, oh, that Hollywood films, Bollywood films.
Yeah.
These are entities, establishment, indigenous to other people. The only thing, whether it's right or wrong, that's indigenous to you and I is Nollywood. Make it work. Give us a voice to speak on the international stage. It will never happen. The best work out there will never find the light of day on the international stage if we don't give it the credence. It's only our people that will make it happen.
And I like what you said, because as somebody that has been in the game for so long, let's say 2006, you thought about where the industry would be in 2021. I'm sure that time seemed like 2021 seemed like such a long time. Now we are here now.
Right.
Is it what you thought? Is it as good as you thought it was going to be?
I've always traveled in time, in space, with energy. My kinetics have always been something different. But believe me, I knew when to leave. I knew when to come back. I know when to go and pursue my goal. I knew when I needed financial independence so that my voice can be amplified at the highest level by me and no one else. I knew it was come when it was time to up my ante, raise the bar, ask for a certain amount to be comfortable. I did. I was even at some point, they banned me for it. When I knew it was time for me to go away and build my financial future, so that when I come back and I want to raise my voice, amplify it to the highest level, it will be with no man standing next to me, because they will give me conditions, terms, that I will not meet. But with my resources, nobody will tell me what to do. You can't tell me nothing.
Set your own terms.
There you go. To set your terms, I did it. I built it 5-6 years. When I was ready, I came back this year. I spoke about this a long time ago. When that ban came, I told them, a whole bunch of you people that are in this room deciding our financial future, our career future, will not be existing in the next 5 years. You'll be obsolete.
That's
you'll
right.
be broke. And it happened. I've always spoken into the future. I've always traveled into the future.
Have some of these people reached out to you?
I've always positioned. Yeah, heck yeah, they reached out. Do you know how many times they try to call me for these movies? And I tell them, what am I coming to do there? I've transcended. I'm so ahead of time right now. So, and I'm telling 90% of them, I still see them, they're broke. Like, they're not broke. So, but that time, they were the lords of the times. And we kept telling them that we have the talent. We have the gift. We're transitional. We will exist for as long as God permits us. You have the money. And that is such, believe me, that's such a superficial link to power.
Mm.
Because the person with a gift will eventually get money and his gift will still be there.
And we'll do it better than you
because all you have is the finances, which at the end of the day doesn't dictate power.
Hmm. Jim, I can't wait for that movie.
Yes, sir.
I literally cannot wait.
Well, it's the best film, man. What you gonna do
most
on
definitely.
Friday?
I'm gonna pull up on Friday.
Yeah, pull, that's the kind of pull up we're begging for. Let people pull up on my movie.
I'm pull up on Friday.
Pull up and fight to get it into my movie. That's what we're begging for. Guys, support your own, my brother. Let's take it to the first film that made that 1 billion. That's the target.
Okay.
Okay, let's make it happen.
And it's very possible because we have the numbers.
I mean, a few of us were done. A few of us were done. Okay? What made Bollywood who they are?
Because of the numbers.
Look at
exactly.
Look at some of the funny, mediocre content that comes out. But they are the richest actors in the world. You know what is going on with us? What's going on?
Because they buy their own and they keep it within
their
family.
There you go. They stand behind their own. You said it all.
Jemai, thank you so much for coming through on the Super Drive Time show today. Sir. Big shout out to you. And we have to do this again, probably like a month from now after the movie has dropped.
Yes.
For sure.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it. Thank you for having me.
Alrighty. Super Drive Time show. Please, please stick around. Quick commercial break. I'll be right back. It's been fantastic having Jim right here with us. And like I said, we are going to do this again.
It's the Super Drive Time show with KC.